You might know china as the fancy plates in your grandma's cabinet that you're never allowed to use. But what makes that stuff so valuable anyway? Today, china doesn't seem particularly durable or rare, but when the Chinese invented it, its strength and flexibility changed the world. When Europeans began trading with the Chinese in the 16th century, the Westerners went absolutely crazy for it. For hundreds of years, Europeans were obsessed with replicating China's recipe for white gold, but they couldn't figure out the ingredients. Then, in 1712, a French priest gained access to the most important porcelain-making factories in China. And in what may be the world's first example of corporate espionage, he stole the secret formula. One of the earliest challenges facing humans was how to contain liquids so you could carry water and simmer stews. And no matter where you were, for thousands of years, the answer was usually pottery. Pottery is found nearly everywhere that civilizations have been. It's a pretty simple idea. Dig up some clay, mold it into a useful shape, and bake it until it's hard. Pottery is made of the same stuff as rocks, and it's kind of hard like rocks, but it definitely isn't a rock. Clay is made of minerals, built from aluminum and silicon, with other trace elements thrown in depending on where you live. The microscopic bits of mineral crystal are suspended in water to form a gloop. If you've ever dabbled in pottery making, you know that your clay can't be too gloopy because it needs to hold whatever shape you're trying to create. Then, once it's shaped, it needs to dry out. Most of the water evaporates, leaving just the minerals behind. Firing, or baking the clay at a high temperature, is what turns it into not quite rock. Before firing, all those tiny crystal bits are sitting next to each other, but they aren't actually bonded. The high temperature is what gives the electrons in one crystal shard enough energy to jump to the neighboring shard and form a bond. In the end, billions of those bonds will stick. The result is a continuous material, with each crystal bit linked to its neighbors. When it came to transporting liquids, pottery was a huge upgrade from the woven or animal skin vessels that came before, but it still had its drawbacks. It would crack at high temperatures, and its surface was porous. Stuff like food gunk or bacteria could easily get into those pores and ruin the pot. One way to deal with the pores was to cover them with something, like a glaze. People realized that certain kinds of ash melt at high temperatures, so as the piece baked, the melted ash formed a glass that was quite good at flowing over the pottery. The glass filled in any gaps and bonded to the clay minerals. If you coated pottery in a glassy glaze, its surface was no longer porous, making it impervious to fluids. Plus, glazed ceramics could be decorated in way more ways than unglazed pottery. But even glazed ceramics were prone to cracks, which usually started in the porous body of the material. If you could somehow incorporate the glaze into the clay itself, then when the material was fired, the pores throughout the entire piece would be filled with strong, smooth glass. That just might solve the problem with pottery. During the Eastern Han Dynasty, around 100 CE, Chinese potters conducted a lot of experiments with clay, adding different minerals to it and firing their pieces at various temperatures. They eventually came across a formula that, when fired at high temperatures, turned into a white, perfectly smooth, and shockingly durable ceramic. They had invented porcelain. The Chinese spent the next several centuries perfecting their recipe and decoration techniques, arriving at their most famous form by the 1300s, a vivid cobalt blue painted on a perfectly white background. Porcelain was so beautiful and practical that in most parts of China, it completely replaced traditional pottery. It was a status symbol and a point of pride for both the crafters and the nation. And their pride was warranted. When Marco Polo first encountered porcelain, he wrote, "It is of such beauty that nothing lovelier can be imagined." As trade routes expanded, porcelain made its way west and enthralled the Europeans. By 1600, they were obsessed with Chinese porcelain. It's estimated that between 1200 and 1800, Europe imported 70 million pieces of it from China. For comparison, in 1500, there were only about 60 million people total living in Europe. Europeans had been making their own ceramics for quite some time, but porcelain was so much better. It was lightweight, heat-resistant, translucent, and strong. Above all, it was a status symbol. Nobles often created entire rooms just to showcase their collections of exotic porcelain. With all of this porcelain coming in, Europeans became frustrated about all their money going out. They were tired of importing this luxury good and wanted to capitalize on the porcelain craze. So they tried their best to replicate it, but they kept ending up with clunky, unimpressive reproductions. They mixed normal clay with some glass, coated it in a bright white glaze, and painted it in an Eastern-style art. But these knockoffs were thick, soft, prone to slumping in the kiln, and definitely not translucent like Chinese porcelain was. They were missing whatever secret ingredients made Chinese porcelain so light and white. Having failed at reverse engineering porcelain, Europeans turned to espionage. The Chinese closely guarded their porcelain factories and processes, meaning foreigners weren't typically allowed to see them. Enter François Xavier d'Entrecôte. When he was just 18 years old, he joined the Jesuits and became a priest. The Jesuit order was known for their missionary work across the globe. But Jesuits took an oath to do more than just proselytize. They were also instructed to seek knowledge that could be useful to the king. It was with this joint mission that d'Entrecôte moved to China in 1698, where he thrived intellectually. He was gifted in Mandarin, which allowed him to translate books and to strongly connect with the locals. He was also very interested in science and took notes about silkworms and the production of artificial flowers and synthetic pearls. He even wrote about smallpox inoculations he observed. D'Entrecôte, like many others, was also interested in porcelain. He started by referencing books on porcelain making that were written in Mandarin. Not learning much from the vague descriptions in the books, he used his connections with the local community to gain access to the factories in Jingdezhen, the porcelain capital of China. Inside, he carefully documented the process. Catholic converts who worked in the factories were eager to answer d'Entrecôte's questions about their craft, and offered additional insights and explanations. Proud of having figured out what baffled so many, he compiled his notes into a very long letter and sent it back to France, postmarked in September 1712. But before I tell you what was in the letter, a quick ad.
Thanks to Incogni for supporting this SciShow video. Incogni are the identity theft and scam prevention people. They work to keep control over your personal data in your hands. If you've ever searched for yourself on the internet, you know some of the personal information that's made its way out there. This could include stuff like addresses, political beliefs, property records, and financial data. But you don't have to accept that all of that data is available to bad actors like scammers and cybercriminals. Incogni can help remove it. Their motto is, they can't harm you if they can't find you. That peace of mind can be found using the code SciShow at incogni.com/SciShow or clicking the link in the description. That link also gives you 60% off an annual Incogni plan. As part of that plan, Incogni will contact more than 270 data brokers on your behalf to request that they remove your personal data, and they'll keep your data off the market with repeated removals. They also have a new custom removals feature in their unlimited plan that lets you request data removal from almost any website that isn't in the automated process yet. Incogni works to keep your private information private, and ultimately, they help you stay on the internet so you can keep finding cool stuff like this video.
In his letter, d'Entrecôte wrote, "The material of porcelain is composed of two kinds of clay, one called patunsa and the other kaolin. The latter is disseminated with corpuscles, which have some shimmer. The former is simply white and very fine to the touch. The first ingredient, patunsa, is sometimes just called porcelain stone. It's made of feldspar and quartz-rich rock, which are the two most abundant minerals in the Earth's crust. While patunsa isn't rare, it's important that the minerals in this porcelain stone are the same minerals that can turn into glass." D'Entrecôte went on to describe an elaborate process for preparing the patunsa, which involved finely pulverizing the stone, washing the powder several times, and then forming it into bricks, which were dried for storage. Kaolin, on the other hand, seemed to require very little preparation. It only had to be mined from deep within a mountainside. It's likely that kaolin was actually a misspelling of Gaolin, the city in which the clay was mined. This was just a local name for the clay rather than a description of its minerals. It was special because it was incredibly flexible and strong. This allowed the porcelain to be shaped into very thin vessels without slumping over. And those corpuscles which have some shimmer that d'Entrecôte noticed in the kaolin were probably mica, which is often found in kaolin deposits. For the best porcelains, patunsa and kaolin would be mixed in equal proportions. But it wasn't just the ingredients that made porcelain special. The other secret was its high firing temperature. The knockoff porcelain in Europe was being fired at temperatures of about 1200 degrees Celsius, but true porcelain had to be fired at around 1500 degrees Celsius. The kaolin doesn't melt at that temperature. The mineral crystals in the clay form the strongly linked scaffold that we expect in pottery. The patunsa, however, does melt at this high temperature. The feldspar and quartz become a glass that fills the pores throughout the entire material. Those two ingredients and the unique firing were the keys. In the rest of his letter, Dontrecoult described the kilns, glazes, and colors the Chinese used to decorate their porcelain. When the French received his letter, they finally had an instruction manual for producing white gold. But despite their espionage, they continued to struggle. And to be fair, Dontrecoult didn't know the specific mineral names, only the local names, and what they looked like during various stages of production. Just take some powdered white rock and mix it with some powdered white clay, duh. Even if he had given them exact chemical formulas, they still would have had to find the proper mineral deposits in Europe. So the French did the only thing they could think to do. They kept stealing. As it turns out, a German alchemist had discovered kaolin around 1709. He had figured out the recipe for white gold through experimentation, and also because his king had imprisoned him until he did so. So that's pretty strong motivation. Using this recipe, the Germans had quietly opened a porcelain factory in 1710. The French sent spies and offered bribes in continued attempts to get the process exactly right. And they finally got their own factory running around 1770 and published a book with detailed instructions for mining the materials and producing porcelain, which is kind of a surprising shift to an open source mindset, in my opinion, but it allowed everyone to make as much of the stuff as they wanted. Having made a huge contribution to European progress, Dontrecoult continued proselytizing in China until his death in 1741. We'll never know exactly what his intentions were when he stole China's biggest secret, but his espionage did change the game for Europe. Porcelain became more accessible in the West, and European scientists continued riffing on Chinese ceramicists' success. In fact, the British ended up with a recipe for bone china, which is probably the type that your grandma has in her hutch. Bone china is made of 25% feldspar, 25% kaolin, and 50%, you guessed it, bone ash. Bone china is even more resistant to chips than porcelain is, which is probably why it gained such broad popularity in the 1900s and beyond. But porcelain is an amazing material, and the Chinese were way ahead of their time. Despite its daintiness, porcelain's unique chemistry makes it resilient to heat and cracks, and its glassy finish makes it easy to clean. This stuff reshaped both economies and daily lives. All that to say, it isn't only sentimental value that makes your grandma's china so special.